last time I gave a lecture, it was at 8 o'clock. And that's when lectures were only an hour. So I've gone from being nearsighted to farsighted. That's not an intellectual thing. I want to thank Mr. Cooley for getting my notes on one page, which I could not do. These notes look like what I did during my sabbatical, and that's what they are. And you'll say, well, what did I do on my sabbatical? But the other thing I'd like to thank is the dean on the lecture committee for letting me give this, because this is a risk, you realize. I know it's always a risk when I give a lecture, but this is especially a risk because obviously we don't do Spengler, but I thought in a way it was my duty to eventually set out what I think is the greatest intellectual threat to the college, which is nihilism, and maybe the West, and to defend the Enlightenment, because the college is impossible, it seems to me, without the Enlightenment. So I'm about to launch. Let me take off my watch. So now you can start timing me, because to see how long I am, whether I go beyond the, you know, 2 or 3 hours that's been allotted to me. It's three? Okay, got it. Why Spengler? Why examine his pessimistic and fatalistic doctrine that the West is in irreversible decline? My answer is quick. Most of us are part-time cultural nihilists. Oswald Spengler is the authority on the decline of the West. He is an intelligent thinker who has the virtue of accepting the onset of nihilism. Spengler resists nothing, attempts to overcome nothing. He has the peace of mind, or in his own terms, the courage to watch the growth of nihilism and to describe it as accurately as he can. Spengler is a nihilist who writes about nihilism as a fatalist. Is the cultural fate of all civilizations to end, and it is the fate for Western culture and civilization to fall to nihilism. We can consult him to see how the expectations of the West have been completely reversed. In contrast to Spengler's picture of the West, we sometimes call ourselves modern Westerners. When we do, we are asserting that the West as it is now is the result of a project begun at a particular time by men who had specific thoughts about human possibility. Political science at the beginning of the modern West promised a return to realism, or at least to the study of the effectual truth. And in the hands of modern natural science, this new realism seemed to make possible the realization of the most extravagant hopes, the relief of man's estate. Since the effectual natural truth, if pursued persistently, has no limits, the progress of the scientific project could go on and on into the infinite unknown. The effectual truth would revolutionize the human world, beginning with the improvement of life itself. Modern natural science until the 19th century seemed to fulfill its promise. Life improved in the West. But by 1882, when Friedrich Nietzsche published The Gay Science, the Western God was dead, and Western humanity was beset by nihilism, wandering aimlessly among its technological achievements. There could be no more real progress because there no longer was a goal. Nihilism, in the end, destroys the civilization that engendered it. Accordingly, it seems that the modern Western civilization contains a great paradox. Precisely that culture dedicated to power, or as Nietzsche describes it, will to power, has an overwhelming sense of its powerlessness. Nihilism, as Stanley Rosen argues, is always a philosophical and therefore human possibility. Philosophy, to be philosophy, must justify the claim that reason is good. Lacking such a justification, philosophy ceases to be reasonable. Most humans, however, are not philosophical. People in this room, of course, are exceptions. And fewer still are philosophers. They require no demonstration that reason is good. That For them, a meaningful life requires that God is good, or at least some Promethean deity is good. That belief makes life worth living. Cultural nihilism is therefore not a human probability. It is rare, and civilizations convinced of nihilism do not long last. Cultural nihilism is the opinion, sometimes the general feeling, that life is not good. Nihilists suffer from ennui or boredom. Life needs a thrill. Nihilism is therefore the opponent of all meaningful human life, whether that life be philosophical or what we might call ordinary. The political philosopher Nicholas Machiavelli and the natural philosopher Francis Bacon could not have intended the collapse of Western civilization when they founded modern political science and modern natural science. Bacon characterizes Machiavelli's writing as follows, quote, "And one of the doctors of Italy, Nicholas Machiavelli, had the confidence to put in writing, almost in plain terms, that the Christian faith had given up good men in prey to those that are tyrannical and unjust," end of quote. Regardless of whether Machiavelli planned to free Christians from the tyranny of their fellows, it is evident that Western civilization developed in light of how Bacon interpreted Machiavelli. Modern natural science is the authority and engine of Western civilization. Bacon, like Machiavelli, intended to make use of those men who have, quote, "natural malignity towards mankind. They are the fittest timber to make great politics of," end of quote. Bacon's reworking of nature included reworking nature's malignity for the benefit of mankind. To some degree, but not entirely, I would say, Bacon's natural science is Machiavellian. What then are the consequences of the combination of Machiavellian political science and Baconian natural science? If modernity is the result of the thought of a few giants, then Western nihilism is one of the great examples, if not the greatest, of the unintended consequence of philosophical study. It is interesting for this reason alone. The larger reason is that the decline of the West is a human crisis, one in which our own part-time nihilism is a piece. According to Spengler, Bacon's advancement of learning has led to the decline and death of the West. In contrast, Bacon, in the Magnalia Natura, that's not pronounced correctly, don't try that at home, a list of technological goals appended to the New Atlantis seizes upon the alteration of life as one of the chief objectives of modern natural science. The effectual truth would give mankind the power to prolong and enjoy life. Undoubtedly, the prolongation of life and youth, Bacon understood, would alter life in innumerable other ways. He suggested, in effect, a revolution in the condition of human life. This alteration is truth at its most effectual. This optimistic beginning brings us again to pessimistic Spengler as the thinker who predicts the wholesale end of the modern scientific project. His philosophy is the antithesis of Machiavelli's and Bacon's, and he recounts the reversal in the history of the West from optimism and expectation to pessimism and resignation. This first part of the lecture has three subdivisions organized around the thought of Spengler. The first division summarizes Spengler's argument for cultural relativism, the form that the Western nihilism adopts. The second division explains how the decline of culture is a consequence of the antagonism between life and thought. And the third is a description of the society and politics of Western decline. The second part of the lecture outlines Bacon's reasons for optimism. Part one, Western nihilism. According to Spengler, all contemporary humans live within a culture, and most live within what he calls a high culture. High cultures are centered around some sort of city. High cultures, which I'll now call cultures, have a determined lifespan that replicates the seasons. A culture in spring, summer, and autumn, Spengler calls by the name culture, and it is maturing. But a culture in decline, in winter, he calls civilization. So civilization is already a term of decline for him. The Greco-Roman culture is neatly divided between the cultural Greeks, we knew that, and the civilized Romans, decline. There were many high cultures, but Spengler concentrates on three that influenced at different times the Western European region: the classical, the Magian from the Persian Magi, and Western. The classical belongs to the Greco-Roman world, and it survived until 300 AD. The Magian comprises the culture that gave birth to most of the monotheistic revealed religions. Its dates are more obscure, although both Jesus and Mohammed are Magians. Finally, Western culture began in Northern Europe about 1000 AD and has been in decline since the 17th century, and perhaps will continue for another 200 years. So mark 2120 on your calendars. Illustrating the power of culture, Spengler maintains that Christianity is really two religions, one Magian and the other Western. Spengler's philosophy is a reversal not only of modern political philosophy, but of the whole tradition of political philosophy beginning with Plato. And of course, the talk about a continuous tradition of political philosophy isn't Spenglerian, right? Because Plato doesn't belong to the tradition of Western. In The Republic, Plato pictures most of mankind as prisoners in a cave. That cave is a product of the social structures and conventions that prevent a people from knowing the truth about themselves and their world. The image was meant to be a great liberator. After Plato, humanity would know that it is imprisoned by social opinions. Mankind could therefore escape blinding convention and lead a truly human life. The contemporary word for the cave is culture. It is another paradox of the modern West, then, that precisely the image meant to free mankind from convention has now become part, and perhaps the greater part, of the cave in which the Westerners sit imprisoned. For Spengler argues that there is no escaping culture, and therefore there is no escaping the cave. To demonstrate that all cultures are unique and isolated, i.e. you can't communicate from one to another, Spengler provides a refutation of Immanuel Kant and his claim that there are mathematical synthetic judgments a priori. I always wanted a lecture where he referred to that, and I never knew enough about Kant to do it. Spengler presents a critique of Kant's explanation of the grounds of number, because if Kant's argument is true, then there are non-cultural grounds for the truth of modern mathematical Western natural science. For Kant, all mathematical judgments without exception are synthetic, and mathematical propositions, strictly so called, are always judgments a priori, not empirical. It is this claim that assures that modern mathematical physics has the possibility of being a true science. Mathematical synthetic judgments depend upon the a priori representation of space and time. Since mathematical propositions are synthetic a priori judgments, they are the same for all rational human beings. And that's all you have to take away from this paragraph. So if you haven't done Kant yet, all you have to know is that Kant showed, if he's right about this, that Western mathematical science could be a science that's true for everybody. Spengler explicitly denies the sameness of mathematics and hence the possibility of a true science not bound to a culture. Quote, there is not and cannot be number as such. There are several number worlds as there are several cultures. If number does not transcend particular cultures, there is little reason to think that other fundamental concepts do. I might say that a cultural relativism that doesn't make number relative is defective. Number belongs to the way in which we cognize the things that have become. Spengler argues that being, so called, is really becoming, which manifests itself in two ways: what is becoming and what has become. Each culture has a number feeling. Things have become in the cultural world according to these distinct number feelings. Classical culture asserted the proposition that number is the essence of all things perceptible to the senses. Extension means, for classical mankind, body. Number is meant to measure the near and corporeal. The classical notion of number expressed itself in the highest classical art, sculpture, especially the sculpting in stone of the naked human body. The classical macrocosm was filled with entities similar to bodies. Each separate thing is well-defined, comprehensible, and a present entity. Kant was so far wrong in thinking that space is an a priori representation that he did not realize that classical culture did not have a notion of space at all. Space is a Western interpretation of extension. It was not part of the possibility of any other culture even to imagine space. Now you can look at the Venus de Milo, which is, it's not a human, shows my prejudice. Renoir didn't think it was a great sculpture. Renoir is a pretty good artist. But when you come onto the Venus de Milo from the distance, so you're walking down the gallery towards it, and the light hits it, you realize that the light in the room has become intelligible by the Venus de Milo. The Venus de Milo, if you really look at it, makes light intelligible. It gives light its intelligence. That's what Nietzsche means by saying that, and Spengler follows him, that the Greeks were Apollonian. Apollo works through sculpture. And body is very important. But that's not the West. For the West, extension is space. And number is pure relation, exemplified by the mathematical function. So not 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Then the typical function, x, is related to y by an equal sign. To see the difference between the classical Western number systems, and consider the difference between the sine of angle theta, and this is my second one, note, and the function sine theta. The sine of the angle theta is a ratio between the sides of a right triangle, a figure. But the function is a curve on coordinate axis repeating itself infinitely. And if you look in the note, you'll see on one of the axes is a little arrow. That arrow would not appear, according to Spengler, in a classical world. That arrow is infinity. That arrow is Western. Although the example of the sine function, in the example of the sine function, we use Cartesian space of two dimensions. Space is where all the possible relations among the numbers are housed. Space in the Western conception is not limited to three dimensions. It is body, i.e. it's classical, that limits the mathematical world to three dimensions. Space has n dimensions. And we see this senior year, right? I mean, the seniors just got off of something called Q space, right? That is more space than the Venus de Milo. Q space, for everybody else, they talk about state domains, but I won't talk that way. You have two particles. They're moving in directions. You three possible directions. You then have six dimensions in Q space. Add another particle, you've got more dimensions. That's a Western thought. Spengler illustrates the difference in Western and classical mathematics with Fermat's last theorem. Fermat's theorem may be expressed this way. There are no integers greater than 2 in the exponent n that allows for a solution for, to the equation x to the n plus y to the n equals z to the n, where x, y, and z are integers. This is different in kind from 3 to the x plus 4 to the x plus 5 to the x. In the second equation, according to Spengler, there are tangible magnitudes. Because x equals 2, there are square magnitudes that satisfy the equation. But the Fermat theorem does not have solutions that are tangible magnitudes. The classical mathematician would not fathom why anybody would seek to know and prove the more general proposition that proposes a relationship that cannot be embodied in a set of magnitudes. Yet we can see that what for the classical mathematician is merely a useless negative proof, for the Western mathematician is a proof about the infinity of possible mathematical relations. Again, we can grasp the meaning of number in the two cultures through the arts. As I said, the Greek master art was the sculpture of the naked human body. In architecture, the classic soul found its expression in the Doric column. It stood for body without direction, without motion. It was the symbol of the classical preference for the pure present, the here and now of the standing body fixed upon the earth. The Greek temple was meant to be seen from the outside as though it were a body without an interior. Quote, in no other culture is the firm footing, the socket, so emphasized. The Doric column bores into the ground. In contrast, the Western soul finds its expression in the Gothic cathedral. The cathedral was built from the inside out, and what was most important was the sense of the inner space of the cathedral. The Gothic Western human built high, and the window was an essential part of the architecture of the interior of the cathedral. In the great windows of the cathedral, quote, can be felt the will to emerge from the interior to the boundless, end of quote. The classic soul, in contrast, attempted to suppress the intrusion of the boundless to its world. So I provided two pictures, one of the temple in Agrigento to Concord. It's one of the temples that you can see the whole of when you approach it. It's very beautiful. The one false thing about that picture is the sky is blue, but so far as I'm concerned, the sky is always cloudy there, and it's pouring rain, and you get totally wet. The other is the cathedral at Rennes, which my family went to see. I was hosting at that time a stomach parasite and didn't get to see it. But you can still see the infinity as you're looking out in at that window. That's the West. That's the West for Spengler. Okay. I was going to mention, but the gates to hell, which I think is a very revealing, I don't have time. We can talk about that later. So now, the antagonism between life and thought. The proof that a particular number of feeling is peculiar to an individual culture, in Spengler's view, refutes Kant. Spengler then turns to the real source of all science, culture. Thinking cannot apprehend reality because it can only appropriate the world that has become, not the actual world, the world of becoming. To apprehend the world of flux as a world of thought, thinking alters the real world. The actual world is a world of becoming. Soul, as it is felt, is the possible, and the world is the actual. Life, then, is, quote, the form in which the actualizing of the possible is accomplished, end of quote. This is also the terms in which the historical progress is put. The soul determines the culture in that it determines the possible, or rather it feels what is possible. Spengler thinks that a culture is alive. Spengler follows Nietzsche in stipulating that history is related to life, or more radically, in Spengler's view, the historical process is a version of life, and cultural history is a manifestation of life. Spengler's philosophy, we can say, is a philosophy of life. The historical process, making the possible actual, is the result of the activity of life. But Spengler is fascinated by death. Life is never life eternal. Even cultures die. For Spengler, humans are time, and time is a synonym for destiny. Time follows the pattern of the individual life, and moves from birth to maturity to decline to death. Life is a species of becoming that has a direction. Humans are time because they have a destiny. Time does not repeat itself, but moves towards a singular end. Our destiny, including our spiritual destinies, are different. But our time-bound nature also imposes a morphological similarity upon all humans. Our awareness of the destiny condition of the living human eventuates in the dread or awe of death and birth for all humans. Only the fully awakened man, man proper, whose understanding has been emancipated by the habit of language from the dependence on sight, comes to possess the notion of transience, that is, a memory of the past as past, an experiential conviction of its irrevocability. We are time. For Spengler, all thought in every culture is a reflection on destiny. Thought is meant, in the first place, to control the threat of death. To confine death, the world must be ruled as much as possible by the individual. Extension is the means whereby the ego keeps the world, so to speak, in subordination. The world picture, which is a term that Heidegger picks up, is a projection of the individual. But to control the world, it must submit to the rigidity of law. Lawful causality offers mankind a sense of controlling the world, but as we shall see, the world of causality compounds the sense of the transience of the individual human. Spengler argues that in all culture, thinking kills being and cannot capture the reality of the historical process. Thought is alienated from life. The price for wakefulness and awareness is high. The basic form of the understood is causality, and causality is, quote, destiny become rigid. Depth is time become rigid, end of quote. The primary symbols of all cultures are a consequence of the rigor mortis of the experience of life. Paradoxically, the attempt to control death, in fact, leads to the control of the apprehension of life by the tool of death, thought. This is an extreme version of philosophy is learning to die. Time succumbs to the deathly influence of thought. Time gives birth to extension, but extension gives death to time. The extension of cognition is, to it belongs our notion of being apart from becoming. In principle, extension is outside time and detached from it and from life. The knowledge that we are in this invisible, rigid extension leads us to know that we have a limited duration. Thought makes the rigid realm of extension, and from the unchanging structure, we apprehend the flux of actuality. Symbolizing life through extension brings the notion of death to mankind. And with extension, the outer world is born. Yet this outer world is particular to our experience of life, because the outer world is dependent upon the extension that is our particular life made rigid. Our destinies are peculiar to the living being that we are as a culture, but they lead to one universal gray conclusion, death. From the prime symbol of extended rigidity arises the entire form language of our culture. It is the basis of culture itself. Cultures themselves cannot avoid death since their symbols, the common language of culture, require the rigor mortis of extension, which is the death of living time. As culturally wakeful beings, we are not entirely living beings, but a combination of life and death. Primitive man, in amazement before death, attempted to spellbound this world of the extended with the limits of its causality. Culture works through symbols which make the incomprehensible comprehensible. Flux is incomprehensible. Symbolism proceeds from the knowledge of death, in which the secret of extension reveals itself. That which resists our sensations in the outer world are not merely things, but things that can be symbolized, things that in our world may be made to have meaning. Symbolism is a defense against the world that would make an end to man. It tames the outer world and makes an emblem of human existence. Consider a totem pole, whereby the local animals are shown to be related to the humans of a particular clan. Humans mitigate their fear of the world's power to produce their death by imposing a sort of death upon the world. They make the world submit to causality and law. Nature, as culturally understood, deadens the world. To reiterate, Spengler argues that thinking kills being and cannot capture the reality of the historical process. Civilization, the final stage of a culture, is much more about thinking than it is about living. To a large degree, nihilism is a replacement of thought of life by thought. Thinking comes forward to escape the reality produced by life. Spengler then can give an account of why his description of the decline of Western civilization is not ensnared by the cultural relativity that he believes describes the situation of the human world. The dying are thinkers and may be accurately portrayed by their thought. Hence, the truth about the age of decline, what Spengler calls civilization, is largely available to those in decline. The death and decline of culture is revealing of the culture from which it's begin, from its beginning, because civilization, as it declines, unthinks the culture. Thinking is inherently nihilistic. You see why we have to oppose this a little bit. Okay, so now I'm going to the controversial part of Spengler. So far it hasn't been. Spengler describes the mechanism that advances culture as a struggle between the estate. Now, by estates, he means things like what the French call the third estate, the priests, the nobility. That is close to life, the nobility, and the one that is thoughtful and opposed to life, the priesthood. Estates belong to the era of culture, that is, the rise of culture to its completed and strongest expression. Since culture is a consequence in the tension between being and the conscious being or wakeful being that characterizes human life, it puts into form the conflict between being and wakeful being. The nobility and the priesthood are these forms. The nobility is the cultural form of life and the priesthood of thought. Because the nobility is connected to life, it is grounded. And property for it means ground property, real estate. In a manner of speaking, civilization is the victory of the homogeneous state over the estates, of formlessness over form, of thought over life. The estates are wiped away and the nation takes their place. The priesthood as an estate is destroyed, but the heirs rule. Puritanism replaces the priesthood and brings it to its logical conclusion. In the cultural period of the West, reason was meant to justify faith. But under the Puritans, reason tested faith. It is only a small step from Cromwell to Hume. Reason cannot give an account of the cultural forms or how they spring to life, but it can explain how they decay. Because thinking is the correspondent of decay. Thought thinks that it can free itself from the actualizing of life, the cultural forms, from the soil. As the culture matures and the life forms of the culture weaken, thought does achieve a greater independence from life because the culture is dying. Our values speech is the final manifestation of a dying and decaying culture and of the freedom of thought from life. Capitalist economics is the overcoming of reality by thought. Who would have thought that? Wealth is transformed from land to money, from a reference to reality to a reference to thought alone. It is one of the ironies of the fat value distinction that the ideal truths, including moral ideals, what we sometimes mean by values, are subordinate to money, because money can be treated as though it were a fact, when it is merely a thought disguised as a fact. Money or value thought mobilizes the world. It is equivalent in human affairs to modern physics with its conservation laws that allow everything to be transformed into everything else. Like the myth of force, mass, and energy that allows, as Heidegger observes, everything to be treated as standing reserve, money allows all human interaction to be treated as exchanges of value. So that's what I'm up to right now. Money treats human valuation as a mathematical function. All value is a quantity, and there is in fact no hierarchy of values, only a quantification. In a Western world striving for the infinite, money impresses with a big number. So millionaires are more important than thousandaires, and billionaires are more important than millionaires, and pretty soon I suppose we'll have trillionaires. The greatest number in politics prevails, but since thought is controlled in governments of free speech by the few, by the newspapers, which will the truth and do not report it, in fact, mass democracy is dominated by the very few who control thought. Mass democracy destroys all political forms. Written constitutions are fables that conceal the actual constitution of power. The money men rule mass democracy. It is their will to power that is free, free from the constraints of life. Eventually, the contempt for forms destroys democracy. There arises a general disgust with money, and the people return to the worship of life in the person of a Caesar. Civilization ends with a leader. A very ominous thought, if you think about it. He wrote this in 1920. Let us complete the picture of Western decline, and this is probably the most controversial but the most important part of his picture, of Western decline with a return to what might be called ordinary life. Under the sovereignty of thinking, what is the character of the Western family? The family is the formal home of life, and thought is deadly to family life. When the ordinary thought, quote, this is, I want to be clear when I'm quoting. When the ordinary thought of highly cultivated people begins to regard having children as a question of pros and cons, the great turning point has come, for nature knows nothing of pro and con. Everywhere, wherever life is actual, reigns an inward logic in it, a drive that is utterly independent of waking being, with its causal linkages, indeed not even observed by it. The abundant proliferation of primitive peoples is a natural phenomenon which is not even thought about, still less judged as to the utility of the reverse. When reasons have to be put forward at all in the question of life, how many children should we have? Life itself has become questionable. At that begins prudent limitations of the number of births, end of quote. The consequences of reason in the family is, according to Spengler, quote, appalling depopulation. Now I'm going to ask your forbearance, or not to blame me for what is about to be said, for the family has been reshaped by the restriction of fertility. It may be that Spengler's characterization of this reshaping will seem reactionary, at best. Yet we need to look at his description, since what is for us unqualified progress may be, as Spengler claims, a consequence of the will to power. We need to reflect upon the will to power in all its aspects, especially those that involve ordinary life. Spengler claims, quote, the primary woman, the peasant woman, is mother. A man's choice of the woman who is to be not mother of his children as among peasants and primitives, but his own, short quotes, companion for life, end of quote, becomes a problem of mentality. The Ibsen marriage appears, the higher spiritual affinity in which both parties are free, free that is as intelligences, free from the plant-like urge of blood to continue itself. As opposed to the mother, now emerges the Ibsen woman, the comrade, the heroine of a whole metropolitan literature, from northern drama to the Parisian novel. Instead of children, she has soul conflicts. Marriage is a craft art for the achievement of mutual understanding. End of quote. That's not me. To speak less harshly, it is evident that the 18th century novel, especially those of Jane Austen, are meant to be an education of the sentiments and the mind for men and women for whom marriage is a rational engagement. The parents of Elizabeth Bennet have a ridiculous marriage because it's based on the physical attractions of a silly woman and the irrational laws of entailment that prevent women from inheriting land. Yet the project of rational education deteriorates by the middle of the century, at least in the Parisian novel, where, for example, in Stendhal's The Charterhouse of Parma, courtship and marriage are merely Machiavellian politics writ small. Even in Jane Austen, the marriages are at least as much, okay, not between Elizabeth and Darcy, as much about money as companionship, and children are a secondary consideration. Modern marriage seems to need the support of the novel, and the fact that we're not reading novels so much, or our novels are kind of dark, might talk about the crisis of the family. Modern marriage does not spring out of life itself. Spengler pictures life on two levels, culture and familia. Both run down together. This coincidence does not surprise us, because like Spengler, we think culturally. We expect culture to affect and perhaps determine our private lives. According to Spengler, Westerners are bored with life altogether. They cease to be culturally creative, and they cease to have children. They are exhausted with rationality, but they have little else. They have come to believe that all things human are a consequence of the will to power. Perhaps all cultures end in civilization and nihilism. But even Spengler admits that the West is the extreme version of nihilism. The fundamental terms of the West are will and thought. Will is another way of expressing what Nietzsche calls our virtue, our historical sense. Quote, the historic future is distance becoming, end of quote. In the infinite space of science, what modern scientists call nature is the historic future made rigid. Will belongs to the West, and it manifests itself in our notion of the ego. Spengler claims that for, quote, every man, whatever culture to which he belongs, the elements of the soul are the deities of an inner mythology. What God is for us, God is the breath of the world, the universal power, the ever-present doer and provider, that also, reflected from the space of the world into the imaginary space of the soul, necessarily felt as an actual presence, is will. The ruler of our inner life, our microcosm, is also the ruler of our macrocosm. Western man cannot imagine God as anything else but will. In Western feeling, direction is paramount. In every time, direction or destiny has an aim. In natural studies, in Western science, entropy is the concept that science was aiming at from the beginning. Space filled with uniform chaos or uniform energy. Entropy is the scientific equivalent to nihilism. Western man has arrived at the willed or directed end. From the very beginning of the West, the goal was entropy and nihilism. Western man always aimed at the world's end as the completion of an inwardly necessary evolution. God is will, and will projects an infinite space. Space, however, is the prime symbol of the fact that the individual man and mankind must end. Space is the harbinger of death. Western man willed the death of his own culture. God is dead, and Western man is his murderer. Because Western man willed the completion of will, Western man willed the death of God. Western man alone faced from the beginning the mortality of culture. It took the fact of mortality and willed it. This is the Western decline, the world of the Western nihilist. Part two, nihilism and the scientific project. If we are not fatalists like Spengler, then in order to avert or mitigate the decline of the West, we seek to know how the optimism of the Western project was transformed into the pessimism of nihilism. Spengler provides us with two related questions to investigate in order to uncover the root of Western cultural nihilism. We will ask our questions in the context of reading Bacon's New Atlantis, finally a book on the program, which describes an isolated, scientifically ruled world accidentally discovered by a ship manned by Europeans. First, we ask, how did the founders of modern natural science alter the understanding and treatment of life so that it could be identified with a historical process that, according to Spengler, inevitably has an ending? Second, how did scientific thought affect Western understanding of everyday life so that we would weary of life altogether? Our questions force us to read the New Atlantis not as an achieved or even an achievable utopia, but rather as it reveals the problems that remain in a scientific nation. As we shall see, these problems, paradoxically, are the instruments that hold off nihilism, at least according to Bacon. My approach to the first question turns on a detail brought to my attention by Mr. David MacDonald and Mr. Christopher Funderburk in sophomore seminar. Christianity is introduced by a miracle to New Atlantis, or Bensalem, which is the name the inhabitants call their island. A cross of light appeared off the coast of Bensalem, and when the people rowed out to investigate, they could only approach so far. By coincidence, there was present at the miracle a member of the House of Solomon, the scientific institute that rules the country. Mysteriously, he was allowed to approach the cross and found an ark with writings on it. It contained the Hebrew and Christian sculptures. Once we see the powers of the House of Solomon, we realize it would be child's play for it to rig this so-called miracle. But the detail that cannot be rigged, and that Mr. McDonald and Mr. Funderburk saw, is that the complete scriptures appear in Bensalem before they were written by the traditional Christian authors. The people in Bensalem knew in advance which writings would be accepted by the Christian churches as authentic Christian scripture. This appears to be the true miracle. Or we may conclude that the scriptures inevitably flowed out of the work of the House of Solomon, which is also called the House of the Six-Day Works of Creation. For example, the Christian sense of time is compatible with the new science. Time is not the classical cycle, but moves in a direction towards an end. Modern philosophy is often characterized as the secularization of Christianity, making the Christian world completely immanent in this world. But for my purposes, it's also true that Bacon's approach Christianizes philosophy. Time gains a direction. What Spengler takes for granted, that time is characterized by directionality, seems instead to be a Christian interpretation of God's providence. The investigations of science occur within the directionality given by the world created at a certain time and perhaps ending at a certain time. The first man who narrates the world of Bensalem is a Christian priest. The Europeans ask him how Christianity came to Bensalem, and he praises them for seeking the kingdom of heaven. Discovering the kingdom of heaven involves attaining eternal life. The seeking of eternal life is the Christian formulation of the end of the six-day works. We are told, quote, "The end of our foundation is the knowledge of the causes and secret motions of things, and the enlarging of the bounds of human empire to the effecting of all things possible. End of quote. Seeking eternal life is seeking to know the providence of God. The history of Bensalem, then, is the history of human life seeking eternal life. The House of the Six-Day Works is devoted to giving form to the actualizing of the possible. The historical process in New Atlantis, as Spengler defines it, begins with the founding of the House of Solomon. For Bacon, it is identified with experimental thinking. By combining pagan philosophy with Christianity, Bacon invents the historical process as an expression of life. With Bacon's philosophy, Christendom is transformed into what we call Western culture. Does Bacon realize the dangers of his project to ordinary life, the danger of cultural nihilism? In the New Atlantis, ordinary life is family life. The European narrator of the work observes the feast of the family and is told by a Jew, Joabin, about the Adam and Eve pools. The feast of the family occurs at the end of a man's life when he can count 30 living descendants from his body and they gather to honor him. The Adam and Eve pools are an institution to help a man and a woman decide whether to marry. But rather than have any account of the family between the beginning and end of marriage, the Jew simply makes the claim that, quote, "There is not under the heavens so chaste a nation as this of Bethlehem, nor so free from all pollution of foulness," end of quote. Then he inveighs against European marriage and the accompanying practice of prostitution. In the middle of this condemnation of Europe, he asserts that there is the general opinion in Bethlehem that, quote, "Marriage is ordained for unlawful concupiscence, and natural concupiscence seems as a spur to marriage," end of quote. Even in the 17th century, the word concupiscence was usually used for unlawful strong desires. Certainly there could be natural but unlawful strong desires. In Europe, as Joabin argues, prostitution and infidelity are permitted in secret because they prevent worse crimes. European marriage and the accompanying abuses of it are branded by the people of Bensalem as Lot's offer. He offered his daughters to the mob in Sodom so that his guests, who were angels of God, would not be sexually abused. Later, these same daughters made Lot drunk and committed incest with him. The biblical approach to marriage seems to lead to all the crimes that marriage is meant to avoid, and it does not lead to better and healthier children, since marriage is not designed to provide goods, including children, but to avoid greater evils. The Adam and Eve pools are meant to secure marriage on better grounds. At these pools, the friends of the man and woman intending to marry are permitted to view the future husband and wife naked. Mr. Cooley left one of the notes off, which was a picture of the Adam and Eve pools. Bacon claims that this is superior to the arrangement in a feigned commonwealth. As the note to the Oxford edition suggests, this is probably a reference to Thomas More's Utopia and perhaps Plato's Laws, where the man and woman are allowed directly to see each other naked before marriage. But the people in Bethlehem find a refusal to marry after seeing the other person naked is too much like scorn. Still, we might be mystified how the Adam and Eve pools secure chaste marriage. There are two stories in the tradition that make us doubt the prudence of this arrangement, one Greek from Herodotus and one biblical from 2 Samuel. I'm going to skip the Herodotus example at Gyges. The biblical story is even more troubling because the name of the Jew in the New Atlantis relating the institution of the Adam and Eve pools to the European narrator is Joabin, which seems to be the biblical name Joab in the language of Bethlehem. Joab, we recall, was a general of King David. King David saw Bathsheba in her bath and was so inflamed with passion that he ended up impregnating her. Since her husband, Uriah the Hittite, was away fighting David's wars, her pregnancy could not be attributed to him. In fact, there's a complicated story about they tried to get it so it's attributed to him, but it doesn't work. In the end, David commanded Joab to place Uriah in the most dangerous part of the battle where he was killed. David then brought Bathsheba into the palace. Bathsheba was the mother of Solomon, for whom the house of the six-day works is named. What then is the meaning of the strange institution of the Adam and Eve pools? I'm going to skip the Gyges explanation. In the case of David and Bathsheba, there is an action of shameless betrayal, since it was David, the friend of Uriah, that initiated the contact with Bathsheba, who succumbed to his passion. In the New Atlantis, chastity stands in for all the virtues of ordinary life where shame and self-respect compete. In the Greek political world, or at least in Aristotle's ethics, the question of shame is treated most directly in the relation of to the virtue of courage. This is true as well in Herodotus. But Bethlehem is a Christian country where chastity is the virtue in which shame is brought most obviously to bear upon human behavior. It turns out the chastity of Bethlehem is a consequence of their self-reverence. Quote, and there, the people of Bethlehem's usual saying is that whoever is unchaste cannot reverence himself. And they say that the reverence of a man's self is, next religion, the bridle of all vices. End of quote. The Adam and Eve pools are meant to minimize shame. I must admit that here, Bacon shows that he is a Machiavellian Christian. Humility is a Christian virtue. But as Machiavelli notes, humility as a virtue opens the Christians to being victims of unjust and tyrannical men. Self-reverence seems to tend towards a different estimate of the self than humility. But the mere removal of shame, as we see in the David Bathsheba example, does not ensure virtue. Vice is much more likely. After the rebuke from Joabin to the European narrator about Europe's marriage customs, the European responds that I would say to him, as the widow of Sarepta said to Elijah, that he was come to bring to memory our sins, and I confess the righteousness of Bethlehem was greater than the righteousness of Europe. End of quote. The quotation in the Bible does not end where the European stops it. The widow says, art thou come to call my sin to remembrance and to slay my son? End of quote. We have no sense that the widow was a great sinner. Indeed, although Elijah was purportedly sent to be fed by the widow, in fact, Elijah's presence increased by a miracle the food available to the widow and her son. If she has sinned, then it is because she despairs at God's providence. When Elijah arrives, the widow is preparing the last meal for herself and her son, after which she says they're going to die. The son does die, but Elijah brings him back to life. And we are left wondering whether the widow was punished because she lost faith in God's providence, and the punishment removed because she repents. In Bethlehem, by contrast, there is no scarcity. God's providence works through the capacity of the people to provide for themselves. Fortune may be overcome because fortune is not God working. The people of Bethlehem reverence themselves by thinking that God's providence works through them. Accordingly, men and women are chaste because they choose their own mates. For the people of Bethlehem, it is their sense of freedom that ensures their chastity and their virtues in general. Bacon notes in the essays, and this is a joke, but it also starts feminism. Bacon is the originator of feminism. It is often seen that bad husbands have very good wives. Whether it be that it raises the price of their husband's kindness when it comes, or that the wives take pride in their patience. But this never fails. If the bad husbands were of their own choosing, against their friends' consent, for then they will be sure to make good their folly. End of quote. Self-reverence is based upon the person acting as a moral agent. Even folly is mitigated by the opinion that the human has the freedom to act for the apparent good. Acting morally, that is, freely, is akin to self-reverence. Hence we see that Bacon reforms marriage and all Christian morality so that there's a moral action and not a response to shame. Bacon begins the emancipation of women. Spengler derides this reform as the inauguration of the Ibsen marriage, where men and women choose each other for the cast of mind instead of the propagation of the species. But behind this marriage is the choice of a spouse as the action of a free being. Spengler disparages freedom since he's a fatalist. And by the way, this is Jane Austen's topic. Freedom. Marriage, then, is the paradigm for moral action, and not only for ordinary life. As Bacon notes, to leave people free leaves them free to pursue follies. Freedom, however, is the source of our self-reverence. Science alone cannot produce humans appropriate for the house of the six-day works. The scientific project must depend upon nature to produce humans with the freedom to pursue God's providence. Not everything is possible. And the creation of free humans of the highest order is incompatible with their artificial production. Freedom is not equivalent to being smarter, an effect that might be brought about by science. Freedom is equivalent to being a moral agent, being a cause. To claim that the scientific project depends upon the natural freedom of humans is to say that morally, not everything is possible. For Bacon, the scientific project that strive to effect all things possible must depend upon the moral impossibility of destroying the naturally free human. To say that not everything is possible is a scientific way of speaking about the moral fact that not everything is permitted. Baconian science is not nihilistic. Nihilism destroys Baconian science. Science is not possible in a nihilistic world. And I failed. All I've shown is that Bacon's scientific project is not the source of nihilism. But perhaps nihilism comes about as a failure of Bacon's project. Let us consider the feast of the family. The feast, as we indicated, occurs at the end of the life of a patriarch. He is in obvious decline since in order to stand, he needs to be supported by two younger members of his family. There is a limit, it seems, to the prolongation of life allowed by the house of the six-day works for ordinary people. Although it is clear that in the cave of the house of the six-day works, there are hermits who have immensely long lives, let us assume that a generation is merely the production of two offspring. Then the appearance of 30 offspring that initiate the feast is the result of four generations, 2 + 4 + 8 + 16, I hope it's 30. Make the age of reproduction something high, such as 40 years. Then the father of the family is about 160 years old. Decay can be delayed, but it cannot be avoided. Moreover, the father of the family adjudicates suits and discords, restores those in economic hardship, and admonishes those given to vice. Indeed, he gives direction to marriages, as though some marriages don't work out in truth. Vice and evil have not been entirely banished from the families of Bethlehem. The father of the family works in conjunction with the governor of the city to restore the health of the family. Hence, some evils persist, and politics has not been abolished because humans, given their freedom, will often choose badly. Leaving humans free means that evil cannot be entirely banished from the earth. It persists. The persistence of evil is due to human free activity. Folly persists because freedom is a limit on itself. Humans must accept the responsibility that evil arises out of their own freedom. The house of the six-day works cannot eradicate all evil because it cannot eradicate freedom. Spengler, we recall, argued that thought is ineffectual. Thought is always afterthought. It occurs after life has produced the form of the actual that thought thinks about. Spengler set up a rigid duality between life and thought. Life disrupts the rigid forms of thought. Classical humans did not think the same way that Westerners do. Life erupts against established thought. But thought also kills life, and thought dominates at the end of civilizations. Indeed, thought is the characteristic form of dying. In contrast, for Bacon, thought is a consequence of freedom. Thought is about affecting of all things possible. Thought may think about the possible even when the possible is hidden. I would say not present. Thinking about the possible scientifically is the kind of thinking that grasps the character of the future. The possible may be made present and is made present sometimes through experiment. The Spengler duality between life and thought then is denied by Bacon. But there is another source of duality in Bacon between cause and effect, between moral cause and material effect, between free and determinate. We may say that the source of Spengler's nihilism is his complete fatalism. Bacon is not a fatalist. Indeed, he is a great optimist because he knows that much good may be done by mankind, in part as a consequence that not everything is permitted morally. There's a detail in the New Atlantis that I find most difficult to grasp. Bensalem is not afraid to show the decay of the father. In fact, Bensalem uses his impending death as an occasion to remediate the general decay of his family. But the mother is hidden. She may see the feast, but she may not be seen in it. Is Bensalem unable to support the vision of the decay of the mother? Has shame returned so that not only must the results of the woman's decision to marry and bear children be hidden behind clothing, but it must be removed from sight altogether? I think that Bacon implies that not many people can bear to know what the mother of the family knows and suffer what she has suffered. She bears the weight of freedom, and this burden cannot be fully shown. Freedom cannot banish evil from the world because freedom must allow human folly. Humans must suffer because they are free, free to seek and free to see a part of God's providence. The seeking of eternal life requires the recognition that humans are not permitted to attain immortality. The good society of Bensalem does not exclude decay. The mother knows, as she looks out on her children and her children's children, that they will suffer. She knows that life is truly tragic, not because humans are powerless, but because they are powerful, and they must restrain their power and permit human folly. This mother is the tragic woman who sees the burden of freedom and knowledge and affirms them. At times, I doubt that Spengler believes in his heart what he says he thinks. Is the duality of thought and life in truth fundamental? Note, I slipped in truth. Bacon argues that there is moral truth. The goodness of his project depends upon it. Spengler needs to argue that truth, and especially moral truth, is a consequence of cultural determinism. Certain virtues are not possible in every culture. Are they therefore virtues? Or when they are applied generally, are they mere importations from one culture to another, a sort of misunderstanding? I have argued that Bacon's project depends upon the truth of humans as moral beings, and whether this is a kind of chastity, moderation, or courage varies with circumstances. But its highest expression, it seems, is a kind of courage. Spengler also freely uses moral language, especially the language of courage. He's particularly harsh about the classical or Greek soul, and originally I wrote this lecture with a Greek response to him. He contrasts it with the Egyptian soul, which he calls the brave soul. He characterizes the Greek attitude toward life this way, and this quotation infuriates me. Quote, If life was worthless, at any rate, the grand gesture in losing it was not so. The Greek willed nothing and dared nothing, but he found the stirring beauty in enduring. The moral of the cynics and that of the Stoics and that of Epicurus, all this is a masked cowardice in the face of grave matters and responsibilities, end of quotes. But the Greeks could will nothing because in their culture, no one had a will. Why employ moral language to evaluate this lack of will? What has cultural relativism got to do with moral judgments? The Greeks, I repeat, Spengler thought, were the people who most lacked a historical sense. Theirs was a world of presence. It is a mystery how the Greeks were possible, since humans are time, and time always and everywhere has a direction unto death. The Greeks were the masters of illusion. Their culture of all cultures most masked the character of life and history. It was the deepest and darkest cave. Accordingly, their morality is the strangest to a Westerner. So why the blame? Why try to shame the Greeks, even in their urge towards beauty and nobility? In general, Spengler is not reluctant to deliver moral verdicts. He closes the entire works with the pronouncement, quote, "For us, however, whom destiny has placed in this culture at this moment, the moment when money is celebrating its last victories, our direction, willed and obligatory at once, is set for us within narrow limits. And on any other terms, life is not worth living. We have not the freedom to reach to this or that, but the freedom to do the necessary or to do nothing. And a task that is historic necessity has set will be accomplished with the individual or against him," end of quote. At the very, very end of his great work, The Decline of the West, Spengler resorts to the language of moral obligation. Why should a life compatible with the direction of history receive this moral affirmation? And how is it that we are free to exempt ourselves from working to achieve the completion of history in its inevitable end? Why has history left us any freedom? How is it that we have freedom to do nothing? Spengler wants some elements of moral agency to remain, some shred of freedom. But Spengler's freedom seems to be confused. It is a strange freedom to do the necessary or to do nothing. But history is leading inevitably to the nothing. It is nihilistic. Spengler sets up a choice that is nothing, both alternatives of which lead to nothing. In the end, Spengler wants to revert to a weak version of the Baconian duality between morality and natural science. Then we can claim, perhaps, the weakening of Bacon's project led to nihilism. Let us return to the beginning, Bacon's Machiavellianism. Bacon interprets Machiavelli as the defender of Christians. In harmony with his defense, Bacon develops the scientific project that seeks to involve mankind more directly in God's providence. But the scientific project itself cannot be a new tyranny. It must restrain itself and allow bad as well as good people freedom. In fact, Bacon will use people with natural malignity to advance the scientific project. He explicitly diminishes the power of shame. It using bad men for the sake of the common good runs the risk of weakening the distinction between good and bad. Bacon makes an Italian joke at the expense of earlier thinkers in the context of praising Machiavelli's purpose. So good that he is good for nothing. This is a reference really to Christians and to Plato and those people. This joke makes it seem that utility is the only standard for good. But in fact, the minimum standard for good is utility. This is sufficient for bad men. If they are useful, they're good enough. It is not sufficient for understanding a scientific project in its grandeur, in investigating the providence of God. It does not suffice for preserving human self-reverence for the many Christians who seek to see divine providence and be its agent. Bacon weakened the appearance of the distinction between high and low to allow for the highest human activities without excessive severity towards the lower human activities. Spengler, therefore, inherits a withered notion of human virtue and freedom, a withering that Bacon's charity towards bad men might prepare. Yet Spengler does not wish to give up freedom and virtue altogether. I said Spengler does not oppose nihilism, but in order to accept it, he has to recast fatality into a kind of morality. The march towards nihilism is driven by a kind of faint religiosity. Everyone, according to Spengler, should be so good that they're good for nothing. We can freely be good for nothing by actively advancing the historical movement towards nihilism, or we can oppose it. Despite the common end of our efforts, one attitude towards history makes life worth living, and another presumably does not. Spengler tries to bring to the end of history an insipid morality stripped of most of its moral substance. We are not to judge the movement of history as good, but as necessary. Life is not good, it is necessary. In his last words, Spengler testifies against himself. We cannot blindly accept the nihilistic verdict of history. Spengler misinterpreted the Enlightenment and deluded Bacon's moral project. We need not make the same mistake. It is urgent that we moderns again seek to know the relation of courage and wisdom. Spengler does not show that the West is fated to die. In this, we follow Machiavelli and Bacon. Fortuna is not a goddess.